हेलो, गुड इवनिंग। लेट्स बिगिन विथ फार्माकोलॉजी टुडे। नाउ यस, फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन आई थिंक टू डील विथ इज फार्मैक बीइंग अ बेसिक सब्जेक्ट, हाउ मच टू रीड, which book to read, I think are important questions that everybody have in mind. Yes. I would say you can stick to medical Tripathi. You have a dental version of this and you have the medical one. And I prefer to use the 6th edition, which is a recent edition, because I personally seen that there have been additions in the classification of the drugs. So it's not a very major change or anything. The classification remains the same. There's just been extra addition in the 6th edition. So read Tripathi 6th edition, but not the dental Tripathi. I wanted to read the medical Tripathi, because there's gross difference between the classification of drugs in dental and medical. So if you have read dental too, I would still prefer if you could use the medical one, because there's a lot of difference in the classification itself. And I think there is always a thing on how much to read in pharmacology. Now let me tell you, I will be frank, alright, it is difficult, the subject difficult. What makes the subject difficult is names, because you have a lot of classification and you have a lot of names to read, and that's where the whole thing messes up. And the reason why we do physiology before pharmacology is because you have to be good with your physio to be able to follow pharmac. And if you know that bit of your physio well, it's easy. It's easy for you to understand the mechanism of action. If it is a drug that is acting on peptic ulcer, if you know how peptic ulcer happens, then it's easy how it could be stopped. So you have simple correlations like that. So okay, 1 second. Okay, is the voice fine now? What I was telling you is, be good at your basics of the systems, and that makes the understanding easy. And what you have to do is understand the mechanism of action. And there is one thing which will need a lot of effort from your side in pharmac, is in terms of by-hearting the names of the drugs. And actually, strictly speaking, if I have to see the previous year's paper, as long as it's restricted to just dental, like the state-wise examinations, the questions are very easy and majority of it comes from the classification. So put a lot and lot and lot of effort in by having the classification of the drugs. And as long as you know the name of the drug, I'm not saying that you have to remember every drug, every action, every side effect. It's humanly impossible. But at least if you know to which class of drug it belongs to. If it's an antibiotic, and as long as you know that Ciprox is the name of so and so, or if adrenaline goes here, just know where, which category the drug falls into, then it is at least easy for you to gauge the mechanism and things like that. There are lots of them, yes, that's why I said it's difficult, but I think with revision it is really possible. We give you a lot of revisions for pharmac, and don't worry, I will drill into the classifications into your system for sure. So that's what I would say, that do it topic wise. Don't look at it as a big pharmacology subject. Go topic wise and keep short goals. Every day take up one system. Take GIT today, take CNS tomorrow, take CVS at that day. It's okay. Take 2 days for CNS, take 2 days for CVS, take 3 days for ANS, it's okay. But take it topic wise and finish classification for every topic, and then it's easy, right? And when it comes to side effects and all that, I think you have to keep it very, the prominent side effects, so that doesn't get difficult. Okay, and as and when we go to the subject-wise topic, I will let you know what the important ones are. Make a note of it. Please keep your book handy next to you. All if you have your keynotes next to you, your point book all ready. How much to read? Yes. Keep it simple, Dhara. It's classification, okay? The main mechanism of action, like for every subject or every topic you would see, if you go to CVS and if you go to anti-angina drugs, you will see the discussion of nitroglycerin. They wouldn't be describing each drug in detail, even in medical departments. There's going to be one standard drug which will have a description, that's side effect. Like if it's penicillin, you read a broad thing of penicillin and classification, mechanism of action, side effect. And then you know only the names and the classification helps for. So keep that as the standard principle for every chapter. Main thing is classification and their broad mechanism of action and their prominent side effects. And then uses, of course. Highly advisable. It's easy. Now keep one note. Don't try and keep two or three notes. You can't have key notes and have your point book and have one more note. Use your key notes as the main base and keep the textbook by your side. As in when we do a topic, I'm going to be taking 6 to 7 classes of pharmacology. And after my today's class, you can go back, pick up Tripathi, read it, and whatever you feel is extra there from your level of understanding, which you feel is difficult for me to remember, make a note of it in your keynotes. And in that, whatever is most difficult, write it in your point book so that you have... Now, point book is something where you enter details which you need to revise repeatedly. So maybe you can enter your classifications there or write your classifications on a sticky note and put it up on the wall so you can revise them again and again. So yes, making notes really helps, but you should know where to stop at making notes as well. Right? Okay, let's start. Let's go to a few definitions. Pharmacology, science that deals with drugs. And then we have pharmacodynamics. Definition of dynamics, easy way to remember. There have been MCQs on dynamics as well as kinetics. Both of them are MCQs. To avoid confusion, I have the, if you can see the definition of pharmacodynamics, I have just the letter D in red. And also, what the drug does to the body, this D is also in red. Now let me first read the definition, which says, pharmacodynamics is what the drug does to the body, and then we have pharmacokinetics is what the body does to the drug. So this can be confusing. What does what? So that's why we remember pharmacodynamics D, and then in that sentence what the drug does to the body, so we have D first. So DD is easier to remember. So in dynamics, what the drug does to the body. So it is basically an effect of... Can I have all your concentration on my class, please? I know we are talking about the basic definitions, but there have been MCQs on this as well. Yes, okay. I'll have some time given to you to chat with each other at the end. No, no, that's fine, but... Yeah, I'm getting a little distracted on that. That's right. Okay. So pharmacodynamics, what the drug does to the body. So here what we study is the effect of the drug. It is producing a biological effect, a physiological effect. So what is the exact mechanism of action of the body, of the drug in the body, is what we study in dynamics. Then we come to pharmacokinetics. Pharmacokinetics is what the body is doing to the drug. There what happens is, how the drug is being metabolized, what is the transportation of the drug, what happens, how is it excreted from the body. These are things that we will study under pharmacokinetics. Be clear with these definitions, they have been asked. And then we have pharmacotherapeutics. What is therapeutics? When we make use of a drug and that is used to cure a particular condition, then we call it pharmacotherapeutics. like for example your anti-cancer therapy drugs or something like that, which cure you from a disease, we call that as pharmacotherapeutics. So applying the knowledge of pharmacology for disease prevention, mitigation or cure, that's called as therapeutics. Next question, chemotherapy. Chemotherapy is when you treat a specific infection or malignancy with a specific drug. Now this will include all your antimicrobial drugs. That will be chemotherapy, also anti-cancer drugs. Then comes orphan drugs. What are orphan drugs? Before I could read the paragraph, let me explain what orphan drug is. Now this is a drug which is important to you in sense that it is required. Alright? So it is definitely important. But it is not very easily available. Okay? And the reason why it is not easily available has different reasons, that the disease for which it is necessary may not be a common disease in the area or in the country altogether. Alright? Or it may be a very rare condition that does not need that drug extensively. Something like a painkiller or an antibiotic is so often needed by the general population that it is very easily available as an over-the-counter drug. Something you just walk in to the medical shop and ask him for paracetamol and he gives you all kinds. So that's something because it's very common. But there are conditions which are so rare, or sometimes it may not be necessary because the disease may not be prevalent. So for these reasons, the drug, although being important, is available in rarer condition amounts. So that is called as an orphan drug. So let us read what it says now. Drugs are biological products for diagnosis, treatment or prevention. It could be for any purpose. It may be for diagnosis, treatment or prevention of rare diseases or conditions for which the cost of development is not expected to recover from the sales of the drug. The drug may be so expensive that there's so much that goes into the manufacturing of it, but you may not be able to get back that by sales. So such kind of drugs are called as orphan drugs. This was only for your understanding. Now, nobody asks the meaning of an orphan drug in MCQ. But what is asked is the list of drugs which are orphan drugs. So here is a list that's important for you to know. Sodium nitrite, calcitonin, protamine sulfide, digoxin antibody. Now, that's an MCQ. Sodium nitrite. And one more thing, can you check in your keynote if all the four names have been mentioned? I'll check on it as well. Yes. Okay. All of it is mentioned, right, for all of you? Okay. Okay. So far clear? Read these names repeatedly over and over again. No, it is protamine sulfate. It's not potassium. It is protamine sulfate. Protamine sulfate is an antagonist of heparin. And protamine sulfate is an orphan drug. Okay, let's go to the routes of drug administration. Yes, it's an antagonist of heparin. Next, we go to the roots of drug administration. We basically divide the one is local and the other is systemic. Now the two main broad divisions of the routes of administration Now, under local, we will be studying three topics. One is topical, that is when you apply it on the surface. Then we have deeper tissue, and then we have arterial supply. One second. Okay. So everything about the local roots where we first deal with the topical, and the topical we have skin and mucous membrane. Now when we talk about skin, we mainly include ointments, gels, powders, and everything that we apply on the surface, creams, ointments, all of those things will be skin applications. Here, you are dependent upon the drug diffusing into the deeper layers. And that will mostly have to be a lipid-soluble drug which can diffuse through the skin, through the different layers of the skin, and then be effective. And all these topical agents that you're using will bypass the liver. Following me? They bypass the liver. All of you know what is bypassing the liver? Majority of the drugs that you consume by the oral route have to go to the liver to be metabolized and then excreted by different forms. So the main system in the body which is responsible for breakdown of the drug and metabolism of the drug is your liver. Now any route where the drug does not go to the liver for metabolism is called as bypassing the liver. Yes. Yes, they have to be lipid soluble to be effective through the roots. Local anesthesia will also come under topical, but that will come under, it could be topical LA will be, yes. The ones that you use as sprays and the ones that you use in a gel form, those will be topical. While the other forms that you inject still do undergo some amount of systemic transportation. Xylocaine Mayank is just a name of, it's a brand name of the drug. So, any form of LA that is used as a spray or a gel would be topical. Then we have mucous membrane, and this also again is like, for example, the gels that we use on the mucous membrane, that would be an example of a topical agent which will have good penetration. They do undergo metabolism, but they don't have to undergo that metabolism in the liver. It does not have to go to their effect is mostly restricted to the site that you have applied it. If it is an ointment that you apply for a burn and you apply it only on this portion, its effect is only going to be over there, and it to a certain extent will only spread in that limited area and will get metabolized and excreted over there. It being an external thing, right? Even if it's on the mucous membrane, you don't really expect anything to go till the liver to be metabolized. So, it does undergo metabolism. And in fact, for the topical route or even the local route of administration, will have less adverse effects. That's an advantage with the local route. I just write it as SE, where that would be less side effects. Okay? Now we go to deeper tissues. For deeper tissues, yes, you will be needing an injection, and here you're not really, this is again local way of injecting into the deeper tissues. Next, then we have arterial supply. Now, this may be a little confusing and I want you to concentrate over here. No, not intra-articular and intra-cecal. Insulin and farm, so it does not come under a local root. In subcutaneous, we will deal with subcutaneous in the systemic route. Let me talk about arterial supply. Arterial supply here again is, remember when you're doing an angiography or something and you would want to introduce a contrast agent, so you will be giving that contrast agent into the artery. Okay, but what happens is its transport or something will be limited in that particular area. That is why we only restricted in a certain area, we call it as a local route. So this is important for you to remember, because arterial supply in such a scenario would be a local route, but we also have something called as intravenous route, right? All of you can remember the IV route. The IV route becomes a systemic way of administration. So it's important for you to differentiate that. Then again, systemic route. Let me just name the topics first. It's oral route, sublingual route. Drugs that are given through the sublingual route is nitroglycerin and clonidine. Important MCQ, very, very frequently asked. Rectal route, cutaneous, undercutaneous, of course, you have a couple of them. And I have for the description of this, so I'll change the slide. Then we have inhalation. And inhalation, a very favorite MCQ that's usually asked. And yeah, I just explained that to you why arterial is local, right? Examples of arterial, I told you, is introduction of contrast agent in angiography. So when you use a contrast agent, you are restricting the transport of that medium into few blood vessels only. It's not like you introduce it into the whole system. And you're using it only for a certain period and for... So it restricts the area or the supply over there. And that is why it becomes a local route. You can make a note of this in your notes if you want. Inhalation, this has been an MCQ one, among all the routes under systemic, okay, listen to me, under all the routes of administration which come under the systemic way, which has the most rapid recovery, the answer is inhalation. That's one of the reasons why your anesthetics, all anesthetics are given by the inhalation route, right? When compared to the oral route or the intravenous route, inhalation, since it is all excreted out through the lungs itself, the whole process is quite fast. That makes it the most, so rapid recovery. Recovery means when you give an anesthetic agent to a patient, the patient immediately comes back, or the time taken, no, there is some time taken, but he comes back to consciousness. The anesthetic effect is lost. So the recovery means when the patient comes back to normal. So that is most rapid for inhalation. Note, make a note of this in your keynotes, it's not there. We have nasal, parenteral, underparenteral, we have subcutaneous. Don't think I'm going fast. I have another table to show you. I'll explain the whole thing again, okay? Yes, inhalation has rapid action. But the thing is, Yohita, that is not the only route where the action is rapid. Intravenous also produces a rapid action, but does not have a rapid recovery. That rapid recovery is inhalation. And rapid action is also there for inhalation as well as other routes. Intramuscular, intravenous and intradermal. I will take this. Okay, I have this chart over here. Okay. You will start with the oral route. This chart is what is there in your keynotes, so don't worry on that. Now, oral route is the most common route of consuming the drug, where you can give it in the form of tablet, you can give it in the form of liquids, and gels, and capsules, powders. So we have different means of administration by the oral route. And it is the most commonly used route, and it's also safe and very, the advantages is it's not invasive. Painless route, you're not using an injection or anything, and does not need an extra assistant. That's the advantages of the oral route. One of the disadvantages is you cannot give this form of administration to a patient who is continuously vomiting, or a patient who is bedridden, who is involuntary, and such kind of cases you cannot give an oral route. The action is very slow, so you obviously cannot use it in case of an emergency. And unpalatable drug, something which tastes really bitter or something which is really tasting bad, you cannot give it through this route. And this route may cause nausea. I will also discuss the reason for nausea is because, yes, I will take that in the pharmacodynamics. You cannot give it in a patient who is uncooperative, who does not want to take, cannot give it in an unconscious patient. There are some drugs which cannot be absorbed, and majority of the drugs which are given by an oral route can be destroyed by the acidity of the gastric juice. These are the disadvantages of the oral route. Okay, so far? No response. Is it boring? Alright, next we go to sublingual. Sublingual under the tongue has fast absorption of drugs, and it is one of the most commonly used drugs for treatment of the angina. That you all can remember, right? That's a very, very, very commonly asked MCQ. And which is the most common drug through which you give to the sublingual route? You all can name the drug. Sublingual may, if it's an angina case, which drug will you give for treatment? Yes, you use the nitroglycerin, right? And that's a very, very commonly asked drug. There's other names. We have clonidine, and we also use methyl testosterone. These are three drugs that are given by the sublingual route. I told you already that there is a rapid absorption of the drug, and this route also bypasses the liver. So there is, yes, it's methyl. Methyl testosterone. Okay, the liver is bypassed. Now about the sublingual route, let me tell you, we always have this common thinking that if it is angina and if you are giving nitroglycerin, it is always the sublingual route, and since it is a sublingual route, all of them bypass the liver and have a first bypass metabolism. No, it's not so. Now, we have this group of drugs, right? You have glyceryl trinitride, you have glyceryl dinitride, you also have tetranitride. So we have different drugs under that GTN series. Are you guys following me? Under that anti-anginal drug, we only don't have nitroglycerin, right? Now, these drugs can also be given by the oral route. Okay. When you give it by oral route, it is obviously going to go to the liver and will definitely have a good first pass metabolism. Right? So, among this group of nitroglycerides, we have drugs which have a low first pass metabolism and also a one which high first pass metabolism. I will specify this again to you when we go to the chapter of CVS. But I want you to remove the general consensus about GTN being only administered by sublingual. It can also be given by oral, and when it is given by oral, it definitely bypasses, goes through the liver for metabolism. Okay? That's been an MCQ as well. That's why I'm specifying on this. So when you read, what is highlight for you in that MCQ is, please see in front of nitroglycerin if sublingual route has been mentioned. If there is no mention of the sublingual route, you can make assumption that they're talking about either an intravenous or an oral or some other route. So be careful with that. Always look for sublingual in your GTN question. We will be doing with that when we go to the next chapter, Udai, the first pass metabolism. It basically means when you're going to the liver for metabolism. Next, only lipid-soluble drugs can be given to the sublingual route, and obviously you cannot give non-irritating drugs because consuming it will be a problem. It breaks down the drug. Anything that is consumed has to be excreted. Before excretion, it will have to be broken down into a number of smaller substances. So that is why it goes to the liver, gets metabolized over there, it gets broken down into it, part of it gets retained, the rest of it is transported into the then onwards follows the normal system of excretion. No. Sublingual will bypass the liver. Dhara, you're correct. It does not go to the liver. Next, we go to the rectal route. Now, rectal route is one of the good routes for absorption, but it may not be as high as other systems. It's one of the commonly used in case of children as well. For children who don't take it to the oral route, you can give a rectal route. You use suppositories in this case. The form that is given for rectal is called as the suppositories. And you use it for treatment of enema or something like that. And even other drugs can also be given. Yes, enema ke liye use hota hai. And you also have other means, other drugs also that can be given, where the drug will be absorbed through the mucous membrane and then delivered. So, in case of the drug being irritant in the oral form, you can give it through the rectal form. And also in a patient who's continuously vomiting. Unpredictable. Enema? Yes. E-N-E-M-A. Dhara, you wanted to know what was enema? Enema is one way of excretion, increasing the excretion, bringing about, yes, expulsion of solid fecus. Then, we go to cutaneous form. Cutaneous again, skin region, you apply it over the specific area, ointments, gels, and bypass the liver. You have highly soluble drugs that, only highly lipid soluble drugs can be used, which is a disadvantage, and again it's not an emergency. Under cutaneous, I was telling you that under cutaneous, we have the most recent mechanism is something called as the transdermal patches. It's a transdermal therapeutic system. Or you must have observed a lot of people with patches on their neck region. They also use it on the back. You get these days pain reducing transdermal patches. So that's a transdermal therapeutic system method. You have this one, hyoscine, very commonly used is hyoscine, and these days painkiller patches are also very effective and very commonly used. And you would have seen, no, that they had white color thing with dots on it, and you have a sticky layer which you peel off and then you put it over there. And one of the main advantages of this patch system is that there's a sustained availability of the drug. Now, oral, what happens, you take today, every drug has a time period, it has a plasma half-life, which means it is active in the body for certain hours. Why do we give an antibiotic 3 times a day or 2 times a day? Because we know that it is effective only for that many hours. Right? So in that case, the availability of the drug, if it is only one dose, you can't hear me? Can you guys all hear me? Is it all clear? Okay. So what I was saying was about sustained availability. So, in case of a patch, the drug will be released in small amounts, but for a longer period. That's what we call it as a sustained availability, where the drug is available for action for a longer period of time. Adhesive patches which have millipores to deliver the drug through the stratum corneum. It is C, not S. In this route also the liver is bypassed. There will be a constant rate of delivery and also predictable route. It's a very convenient and a better compliant. But one of the disadvantages is it can cause local irritation. But even if this occurs, it's a mild condition and this is also rare. So it is still an advantageous system. Let's look at the drugs which can be used by this method. We have nitroglycerin, fentanyl, nicotine and estradiol. These are the list of drugs available in India. Could be an MCQ, so be familiar with the name. Nitroglycerin, fentanyl, nicotine, estradiol. Four names which are available in India. Hyoscine, clonidine, isosorbide, dinitrate available in other countries. Hyoscine, I think, is available even here. These are the list of drugs that can be used by the transdermal system. Then, we have inhalation. And what was the one point that we read about inhalation which has been asked as an MCQ? What did we read? Very good. Rapid recovery. Let's look at what this is. Has a very rapid action. It diffuses back when the administration is stopped. So a drug concentration can be controlled. It can cause irritation of the lung. Nasal route. Please, important to differentiate between nasal and inhalation. Okay. Nasal route is what we give in cases of treatment of asthma. We have a nasal sprays and also those which is used for cold or nose block. And here where the drug is taken up by the nasal mucosa. So that's where the transportation takes place. Okay. And also your nebulizers, nasal nebulizers, that's also the nasal way. This also bypasses the liver and the digestive juices. Now we go to the parenteral. All this while we've been dealing with systemic routes. And now we have the parenteral route. Parenteral route is when you have an injection and when you are inserting all inside the body and all of it goes... I mean, it has a wide area of distribution inside the body and you have more side effects in these cases. So, majority of the organs get exposed. But let's look at the advantages and disadvantages. Although it has a faster action and liver is bypassed and you can give it in an unconscious patient, these are the advantages. And disadvantages, it is a very risky procedure. You have vital organs involved and you could risk it. The whatever preparation you do should be sterilized. And another disadvantage of it is always an invasive procedure. And another disadvantage that you have to make out is all of you having a voice lag. Okay, let me refresh. Just give me a second. I will be back. You all can just be connected and I would refresh. Okay, can you all see the slide and how's the voice? Is it all fine? All right. Yes, we're talking about this being an invasive procedure and this also needs trained professionals to administer it. Next, we go to the subcutaneous route. Now, subcutaneous route is you're going two layers below the skin. Okay? In case of subcutaneous, that is when you're giving insulin injection, a self-injection is possible. Use a short needle. So an insulin injection would be a subcutaneous route. Everybody has a slide now? Okay. Now, the disadvantage of a subcutaneous again is you cannot give a drug which is irritant, and it also cannot give it in a patient who has a shock, because they will also be they will already be under vasoconstriction. Now, why is a subcutaneous route so effective? Because in the subcutaneous region of the skin, there is more vascularity. There is an increased vascular distribution, but less nerve supply. Okay, that's what makes the subcutaneous route effective. Increased vascularity. Is there an audio problem for everyone? Am I talking too softly? Can you hear me? Is it fine? Okay. For those of you who have a problem, may need to refresh, and if you guys... Okay. Okay. Next. There are three forms of subcutaneous routes. Three forms. One is dermojet, the second is pellet implantation, and third is biodegradable implant. All of these three come under subcutaneous route, and that's an MCQ. What is a dermojet? A dermojet is, have you all heard of jet injections? One of it is your dermojet. So it basically will have a high velocity jet. Okay. Can you see me? Is the audio video fine now? Alright. Let's proceed. We were talking about dermojet. And what dermojet is you have a microfine orifice. There is no injection here. Adjusting a little. Can you see the video and audio now? I mean, can you hear me? Okay. Saurabh, please check for the internet connection. Okay. Okay, guys. Can you listen to me? Okay, we can expect a little internet problem today because it's been raining over here, and I think there must be a problem connection with that, okay? If it is too much of a problem and if it's really nuisance, I will postpone the class. But till then, okay, at least give me about half an hour's time or so. We'll just see. If it really gets bad, I think we will just postpone the class to tomorrow. What do you all say? Because the only reason I see in terms of the internet may be problem from my side is because there's been heavy rain here. Okay, so we were talking about dermojet, which is a jet injection where it's a painless procedure. we only have a microfine orifice through which a high velocity solution of the drug is administered in a jet form. That is what is dermojet. Okay? Did all of you get what is dermojet? Alright. Next we go to palate implantation. In palate implantation, you have a trocar and you have a cannula. And with the help of a trocar and a cannula, you take a big lump of the medicine and then you implant it inside. So then again, there is a sustained release of the drug over a period of time. That is a pellet implantation. Next, we go to a biodegradable implant. The difference between a pellet and a biodegradable is, like I said, in this, you just have a lump of the drug that is placed inside. But in a biodegradable, you will have a nice fancy capsule or covering that has the drug within it, which will be placed inside. Now, non-biodegradable means it may be a metal or something like that, which will have to be placed and after a while removed. That is a non-biodegradable implant. But if it is a biodegradable one, once placed inside, you don't have to worry about it. The drug diffuses, and as soon as all of the drug has diffused into it, the covering that is outside the drug will also dissolve. And in all these cases, at least in these two cases of pellet and biodegradable, in both these cases, there is an increased advantage of a sustained availability of the drug. So far clear? Any doubts? Okay. Next is intramuscular route. Intramuscular again has a wide area. I'm not really sure of the size. You need to be able to place it inside. Yeah, that has to be the only way you implant. So definitely, that's why it's an invasive procedure, right? Okay. Then we go to the intramuscular route. Intramuscular route again has a very good distribution. Implant means, Saurabh, you can have it anywhere. It does not necessarily be beneath the skin. It could be anywhere. It could be inside any system. But definitely, internal. Definitely internal. Yes, subcutaneous, yes. Then, I was going to muscular, intramuscular, and where we say that there is a good absorption from the intramuscular route. It has a very good absorption. The simple reason that there is a wide coverage area. And good vascularity. Again, there is very good vascularity and good area because of which there's good absorption in the intramuscular route. This is of course when you talk about it individually, or when you compare intramuscular and intravenous, or compare intramuscular, if you compare with oral, okay, let me tell you this way. Intramuscular when compared to oral, the IM route has better absorption than the oral route. If you compare intramuscular with intravenous, intravenous has a better absorption rate than the intramuscular. Is that fine? Are you guys clear on that? Next, we go to the intravenous route, and a very, very important point that I want to talk about is it has 100% bioavailability by the intravenous route. The most characteristic feature of intravenous, a very favorite and a commonly asked MCQ, I will tell you what it means. This means that it bypasses the liver. It does not go to the liver for metabolism. So in that case, whatever drug has been administered through the IV route, all of it is available for action inside the body. If it's 1 mg given, full 1 mg is available for action in layman terms. That's what we mean by 100% bioavailability. It has a fast action. Earlier we kept reading, no? If it is a mucosal tissue or if it is even a subcutaneous or if it is skin, you cannot give an irritant drug. One of the advantages of an IV route is even an irritant drug can be given because of the tunica intima layer of the blood vessels is insensitive to these irritant drugs. So because of this, you can make use of this and give even an irritant drug. Of course, you cannot give a highly irritant drug. That's a clause to it. But this is one of the most risky routes because any of your vital organs will get exposed to a high concentration and you can cause damage. And next we come to the intradermal route. In the intradermal, this is, you're just giving it underneath the skin. Very superficial. You're not even going to the subcutaneous level over here. Just beneath the skin. Okay? And it is so superficial that when you give a drug, you will be able to see a blip. And this is especially seen only in the epidermis. So you will be able to see a raised portion when you give an, suppose you give an injection over here in the intradermal area, you will be able to see a raised surface, which means you've just given it very superficially. That's what is intradermal. Where do you give an intradermal like this? It could either be a vaccine or even when you're doing a test for which vaccine is given like this, it is the BCG vaccine that is given in the intradermal way. And also when you're doing a test for tuberculin test, the Montoux test specifically. That's also given intradermal. So it is used only for special purposes. Okay, this is about the different routes of administration. Do we have any doubts still here? Okay. Intradermal is just one layer underneath the skin. So it is superficial. Okay. Subcutaneous. You're going underneath all the layers of the skin. Like your dermis, intradermis, so you could, you possibly inside the connective tissue here. So that is subcutaneous. What was the other one you had a doubt with? Okay, cutaneous. In the cutaneous route, you are still in some layer of the skin. One of the layers of the skin. Okay, but not on the surface. What is on the surface of the skin is the transdermal patch. Because you're placing it on the exterior. You're placing it on the outside, the transdermal patch, and it will transport that material into the stratum corneum. What is stratum corneum? It is the superficial most layer of the skin. That is transdermal patch. What is an implant? Okay, in implants I told you we have a biodegradable implant and a non-biodegradable. In either case, it is something where you cut open a certain layer and you place that pellet. It could be a cylinder with a drug inside. So you take that cylinder, you place it inside and leave it over there. So that releases that drug for a longer period of time. Once all the drug is released, the outer covering will also be degraded, which makes it a biodegradable implant. That's an implant. Okay? All clear? Okay. I will need you to log out and re-log in again. And for my next session, we will be starting off with the dynamics and the kinetics of drugs. Okay? See you at 8:05. You have about 4 minutes for the next class to start. Be quick, okay?